So welcome back, and this is the continuation of the earlier video. So in the earlier video we have seen the basic operation of a moving iron instrument, where we have derived this equation using the energy conservation principle. Okay, now one thing is very very important to note here, that in MC instrument theta was directly proportional to I, so that had an important advantage, that the scale was uniform. Okay, here theta is more or less following a square law. So theta, if it is directly proportional to I in the case of MC instrument, that is, it can only be used for unidirectional current flow, that is for DC current flow we can actually use that instrument. Why? Because when current reverses its polarity, theta also has to reverse. Okay, so that will not happen. Okay, well, so consider our power supply, which is having a 50 hertz frequency. 50 hertz frequency means the total time period is 20 milliseconds. Okay, and the cycle changes, the current direction changes within 10 milliseconds. Okay, positive half cycle changes to negative half cycle after 10 milliseconds. So within that 10 milliseconds, if the current direction changes, if the polarity of the current direction changes every time due to inertia of the meter, the pointer cannot catch up with the change in polarity of the meter of the current. Okay, so since the current is changing its polarity at every 10 milliseconds due to inertia of the meter, the pointer cannot catch up with the polarity change of the current. So what happens? The pointer becomes idle. That is why we never use MC instrument for AC applications. We use MC instruments only for a unidirectional flow of current or DC measurements. But here you can see that as theta is more or less proportional to I square, there is an I square term coming. So whether it is positive directional, whether there is bidirectional flow of current, what happens? The polarity will always be positive, or the deflection always will be in one direction. Okay, irrespective of the polarity, the deflection direction will be in one direction, because when you square a term, obviously the value will be positive, and that is one of the major advantage of this instrument, although it is having some disadvantage regarding the uniformity of distribution of points in a scale. Okay, so we are going to have a discussion based on that is shape of scale of moving iron instruments. Okay, see, half is a constant, k is a constant, dl by d theta is not at all a constant. Okay, so it is possible if there is no saturation inside a meter, you can tell that dl by d theta is more or less a constant, but that is not the case. Saturation is there, many non-linearities are there, so dl by d theta is not at all a constant. Okay, so it is possible to make majority of portion, considerable portion of the scale, more or less uniform by making some design adjustments. I repeat, you can make considerable portion of the scale more or less uniform if you make some adjustments in design. Design of what? Design of the shape of that vane. Okay, the position of the vane, the shape of the vane, dimensions of the vane. That these three things are very important. That is, position of the vane, dimension of the vane, and it is written here. That is shape of the vane, shape, dimension, and position of the iron vane. By choosing that correctly, we can actually make considerable portion of the scale more or less uniform. Okay, so from this equation I'm making this equation dl by d theta equal to, in that way, that is a starting point of that. So dl by d theta equal to 2k theta by I square. Okay, so I made three points, that is position, dimension, and what the next point, that is by making that is the shape of the vane. These three things we are actually trying to make a linear relationship for the current. That is, current is directly proportional to theta, that is, current is equal to c theta, where c is a constant. So by making such a thing, we are making I having a linear relationship with respect to theta. So instead of I here, I can substitute c theta. So if I substitute for I here, it becomes c square theta square. One of the theta at the numerator gets cancelled. What is remaining is dl by d theta equal to 2k by c square theta. Or if you bring this theta to this other side, 2 is a constant, k is a constant, c is another constant. So theta into dl by d theta is a constant. Okay, that means if one increases, the other quantity should decrease in that manner, or if one decreases, the other quantity should increase in the same way, so that this equation will be maintained. Okay, so at any condition, theta dot dl by d theta should be a constant. Okay, so that means what happens if theta is zero? If theta is zero, then dl by d theta should be infinity. That is the meaning. That is, if theta is zero, then dl by d theta equal to, that should be equal to infinity. The thing is that, the conclusion is that I made a point that for considerable portion of a scale can be made uniform. Okay, that means we cannot make uniform the lower end of the scale. That is, towards the small angles, towards the starting point of scale, you cannot make a dl by d theta. You cannot make it constant. The theta dot dl by d theta at as a constant. Why? Because when theta becomes very small, dl by d theta tends to infinity. So practically, it is possible to make linear scale from maximum deflection down to 1 by 10th of the maximum deflection. That is, from maximum deflection theta point down to 1 by 10th of the maximum deflection. Okay. So if I plot dl by d theta against theta, whatever sentence I have made earlier can be viewed from this graph. That is, dl by d theta taken along y-axis, theta taken along x-axis. If you do that, you can tell that is from theta, the maximum deflection, to 1 by 10th of the maximum deflection, you can expect more or less a uniform scale. This region we are living, okay, because you cannot work with this region, because when if you work with this region, you cannot expand this region. If you try to expand, what happens? If you try to expand, then dl by d theta tends to infinity. So we leave it as such, that this small portion, that is the starting point of the angles, will be very crowded. The points at the starting of the scales will be crowded. Okay, one more type of explanation I can keep, that is, you can tell that theta is more or less directly proportional to I square. Okay, so when current becomes, at the small deflection points, current will be very small. The square term, a small quantity of current squared becomes even smaller quantity. So what happens? The area or the points of the initial angles will be very close to each other, so that the lower portion of the scale will be very crowded. So the two reasons, that is, if I make theta equal to, when theta becomes smaller, dl by d theta tends to infinity. So this portion is left over, or you cannot expand that region. Another explanation is that I being very small in the initial part of the deflection, when we take the square of that term, becomes even smaller. So the points, initial points in the scale will be very close to each other, or they will be very crowded. Okay. And one more thing is that towards the maximum, towards the other end, that is towards the maximum deflection points, again, you can see that the points are slightly crowded since the change in rate of change of inductance with respect to angle decreases rapidly. So usable range is around 80 degree of its length. That is, overall taking the overall scale, the usable length is 80 degrees. Okay, that is the shape of the scale in the initial portion as well as the final portion. The scales or the points will be crowded. Okay, now next thing is that in MC instruments, we have used shunts for making it as ammeter, and series multipliers for making it as voltmeters. Now, for MI instruments, there is no need for shunts for higher range measurements of currents, or for converting the basic instrument to an ammeter. Okay, here, uses the same setup that we have seen construction-wise, we can measure up to 50 amps. Why? You can measure up to 50 amps using the basic setup we have seen. Why? Because the current carrying coil is stationary here. Since the current carrying coil is stationary here, since it is not moving, it can carry a capacity current up to 50 amps. So there is no need, particularly there is no need to have a shunt like this. Okay. Normally we never use shunts in an ammeter, since it can easily measure currents up to 50 amps. And if at all you have to measure currents above 50 amps, you can utilize current transformers. That's one type of instrument transformer. We learn that in later stage. Okay. So if at all you require to measure currents above 50 amps, you can use the help of current transformers. So shunt meters we never use, and but multipliers are required for converting that into voltmeter. So this is my multiplier RS, which is connected in series with the meter. This is of high resistance, so that majority of the impedance will be of the value of RS. Okay, so RS will be the majority portion of the total impedance. We are not telling a resistance hereafter, because we are considering with AC meters, inductance is also coming. So as RS is high, majority of the impedance will be occupied by RS. Okay, now there are some errors, the errors coming. You can read that such errors, they are very simple. That is hysteresis error, because wherever magnetic field is created and wherever H and B are there, B will be lagging behind H. So if we increase or decrease the value of current, correspondingly the magnetic field may not decrease or increase. Okay, so that may induce hysteresis error. Okay, and some other errors also are also there. Temperature errors are there. You can go for swamping resistances. We use swamping resistances also. Then stray magnetic fields are also there, because the magnetic field inside the meter is very high. Unlike the MC instruments, where you have magnetic field of 1.5 Webers per meter square, here the magnetic field is very weak. That is only in the order of 0.06 to 0.0075 Webers per meter square. Okay. Another very important thing that you have to note is the frequency error, because you have components or elements which depend upon frequency. If frequency changes, then the inductance as well as capacitance value may change. The inductance may change. So that can cause errors. Okay. So that will actually come in the case of what? In particular voltmeters. So frequency errors can be nullified by. So this is actually the voltmeter. That is, this is the inductance and resistance of the meter. And this is a series resistance that we are adding, a very high resistance. And that frequency dependence can be avoided by having a shunt capacitor across what the series resistance. Okay, so I will just explain that very quickly. So what we are trying is that the overall impedance should be equal to RS. Overall impedance, if it is equal to RS, impedance if it is equal to RS resistance, then that means resistance is independent of frequency. As resistance is independent of frequency, we can avoid or minimize the frequency errors. Okay, so that we have a capacitor here connected across RS here. Okay, so how does that help? So overall impedance is nothing but j omega l plus this is negligibly small, I am neglecting this one, and then this combination RS and C parallel combination will have this one, that is RS by 1 plus j omega C RS. Okay, I take the conjugate of this one. What is the conjugate of this one? 1 minus j omega CRS. Multiplying that with numerator and denominator, I'll get this one. And you can see that this term, that is omega CRS, is very small. So if I multiply, if we find the square of omega CRS, then that will be even smaller. So that will be less than 1. So I can neglect this one, but I can make it 1 assignment. As this is very small quantity, very much less than 1, I can make a major assumption, that is j omega l plus this quantity itself multiplied by this. As this is more or less very small, I can consider this as 1 itself. So I can take this as 1 minus omega square c square r square r square, because this quantity is more or less equal to 1. So if I multiply 1 with this quantity, that doesn't make any difference. That is why. Okay, I open everything. I group the terms of real and imaginary. Okay, and then what happens is that, see, for making the whole quantity frequency independent, the whole quantity impedance should be equal to what? RS value. Okay, so that means I have to equate Z to RS. So if I make Z to RS, so RS square is substituted here. RS. So after simplifying, what you get is this one. Open all the brackets, everything. Higher order terms are again neglected. And after that, this is just an explanation, just you can understand this one. Afterwards, you get just find the value of, you get an equation like this. You equate to 0 and you get that L is equal to 2.41 C RS square, or C is equal to 1 by 2.41 L by RS square. That is equal to, the shunt capacitance should be equal to this value. Okay, so if you connect a shunt capacitor like this, you can